أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد والثناء لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين أبي القاسم المصطفى محمد
اللهم صل على محمد وعلى محمد
وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المظلومين سيما بقية الله في الأرضين عجل الله تعالى فرجه الشريف ولعنة الله على أعدائهم أجمعين إلى قيام يوم الدين رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي امري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي. My dear brothers and sisters, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Again, I express my congratulations to all of the brothers and sisters here on the walada of our holy eighth Imam, al-Ridha alayhi salatu wassalam. Inshallah, what we'd like to do tonight is to continue the discussion we had last night, but try to shift into one of the riwayah from the Holy Imam, and there are a few points that we'd like to extract from that, but at the same time we want to make a connection to the discussion we had last night. So if you remember, the first hadith we started with last night was trying to outline the importance of commemorating these events and why it's important for us to gather and for us to attend events like these. And we concluded from the narration that we had from Imam Ali, among other narrations that we have, that he said Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blesses or has mercy on a servant that is able to revive or revitalize the affairs of the Ahlul Bayt alayhi salatu wa salam. And if a person is able to learn and study the sciences, the truths, the secrets of the Ahlul Bayt alayhi salatu wa salam, then teach others, people will naturally be drawn towards them and naturally be drawn towards their truths. So after establishing that, we spoke about the necessity of imamah and how it is completely tied to and connected to the concept of prophethood. And we concluded that the main objective from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sending guidance in the form of prophets and the imam is for them to be able to help us excel our spiritual potentials that exist within us, and for us to be able to achieve those levels of excellence that have been outlined in the Holy Quran and have been outlined in the rawayat and of the narrations of the holy imams. So in establishing that, tonight I'd like to share a rawayah, a narration from Imam Ali, which we have many narrations like this that speak about this. So the points made here are not necessarily exclusive, but I felt like this narration has a good amount of content that allows us to understand many aspects of the points that are being made. So this is a narration found in the book Tuhaf al-Uqul and al-Rasul. This is an important book for us to be familiar with, and at least for us to have heard about something like this. This is authored by a great scholar of ours by the name of Ibn Shu'ba al-Harrani, who lived in the 4th century after Hijrah, and he lived in the same era as Shaykh al-Saduq, which is also a very big personality within Shia scholarship. So it's important for us to familiarize ourselves with not only these scholars, but also with their works and why they're important for us to be able to understand the sciences and the teachings and the secrets of the Ahlul Bayt. Because the riwayah says, يَتَعَلَّمُ وَلُمَنَا. So we have to learn these from somewhere. Where is it going to be learned from? I think the best service that I can do, a person in my position who's not very knowledgeable, has not learned very much, at least we can play the role of being a connection to put your hand or others' hands into the hands of true scholars, proper scholars. And when you're in the hands of people like that who are learned, of course they can be great teachers and educators for you. So please, if it's part of your educational program to suffice to discussions like these, hopefully, I know your speakers are usually a lot better than this, so I do apologize, but try to extend that to a more formal and traditional forms of education, inshallah. So this riwayat is found in Tuhaf al-Uqul from Ibn Shu'ab al-Harrani. It's commonly known that he is one of the teachers of Shaykh al-Mufid. Again, these are big giants within Shia scholarship. This is narrated from Imam Ridha alayhi salatu wasalam. He is trying to present 10 characteristics and 10 attributes that are found within people who are possessive of intellect. A person who is considered to be an intellectual within Islamic boundaries and doctrine. He is discussing 10 characteristics of other characteristics that do exist. So he's not trying to say an intellectual is these people. A person who has been able to achieve true intellect is possessive of these qualities, and these sort of attributes should resonate within him. We know in intellect, the intellect, being an intellectual is very important in Islam. As to what the intellect is, what the aql is, of course there are many levels of understanding this concept of the aql. We have narrations that reference the first creation that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made was that. أَوَلُمَّا خَلَقَ اللَّهُ الْعَقْلِ. So what is this aql? Is this thing in my head? Is it my intellect? Is intellect something more than that? Is intellect some sort of universal truth? In any case, intellect, whatever it may be, is important for every person to be possessive of that. In the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes it very clear that a person who is possessive of intellect and is intellectual cannot be considered equal to a person who is not intellectual. A person who is able to tap into the faculties of reflection, of pondering, these are people that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is happy with, and these are the people that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives virtue to and is pleased with these sorts of people. People who think, people who reflect, people who are able to intellectualize, rationalize things. Not just hear them and accept them. Not just be in the presence of them. For a person who's able to digest something. It's one thing to be force-fed something. It's one thing to be in the presence of something. And it's another thing for a person to willingly, understandingly, take something and digest it and make proper use of that. So whatever the intellect may be, it's important. And in this riwayat, 10 characteristics the Imam is outlining who an intellectual is. وَقَالَ عَلَيْهِ السَّلَامُ لَا يَتِمُّ عَقْلُ امْرِئٍ مُسْلِمٍ حَتَّى تَكُونَ فِيهَ عَشْرُ خِصَالٍ. So the narration from the Imam is, he states, the intellect of no Muslim is complete until it exists within the intellect these 10 characteristics. Again, there's no exclusivity here, but these 10 of course must exist. The first two. الْخَيْرُ مِنْهُ مَأْمُولُ وَالشَّرُّ مِنْهُ مَأْمُونُ. These two are close to one another. The first characteristic and the second characteristic that a person who is possessive of intellect should have is that they should be an individual who from them is created goodness. From them is created service. They should be a source of service and goodness towards others. What is expected of them is for goodness to be a product of their existence. And at the same time, they shouldn't be a person who is the cause and the source of evil, cause of hardship. That means their objective, the person who is possessive of intellect, is a person who is able to remove barriers from the lives of others, not to create barriers for them. To remove the stones that exist within the paths and the roads of people who are trying to live life, not to throw stones in front of other people or at other people. A person is there to serve other people. That means when they see you, a person, they say, that's an intellectual, this person has a complete intellect, he's a person that you're always expecting him to do something good. You don't want to distance yourself from him because all you're expecting from him is for him to create trouble. This is how we dictate what relationships we have. When you say, I don't want to spend time with that person, why? Because he's possessive of some quality that you know there's some evil, some badness, something undesirable within that person that you want to distance yourself. And on the flip side, a person who's possessive of goodness, it resonates and people can pick up on that, and hence they like to associate themselves with them. And you'll find the person who's possessive of more excellent behavioral qualities, people are naturally drawn towards that person, like a magnet. Because people are naturally drawn towards goodness, they're naturally drawn towards the truth, they're naturally drawn towards things that are real. And hence the person who's possessive of those things, people, whether they know them, whether they acknowledge them, whether they have association with them, they're naturally drawn towards them. In one instance, a person can be completely in love with another, and at the same time a person can have spent a lifetime with another person and can't stand to be in the presence of them and to be in the same room with them. So service to others, public service to others, is very, very important and instrumental in Islam. It's very important. It's one of the keys for a person to be able to excel, to be someone who's producing something that has some sort of utility for other people. First, be able to establish it within yourself, within your own families, and then have some sort of utility for other people. So when people see you, says, yes, this person, I know they can do something good. Not that you're always trying to clean up after each other, clean up after other people. If you're a person who everywhere you go is creating a mess, others have to clean up for you. And naturally others don't want to have to associate with you. This is something very common we see in events where we have larger crowds. let's say Muharram or Ramadan, sometimes in masjids that we have cleaning crews, a lot of times they will be fed up when they're cleaning, they'll find things, little hidden gems around the masjid. Generally when they serve dates, because it's so small and it's very difficult for a person to hold the seed of the date in their hand or in their pocket or something around them, they're very creative in finding ways to hide this date seed. And when the person who's cleaning, they're vacuuming over, sometimes the vacuum picks it up and makes a nice sound. But sometimes years after, when they're trying to clean an area that doesn't require like very common, frequent cleaning, and let's say they open this up right here, whatever this is, maybe it's an air conditioner, whatever. They'll open it, they'll find it's full of date seeds, right? So there are no dates there, and I'm sure the rodents haven't eaten the dates, so someone has eaten the date, alhamdulillah, that's good. They're very delicious, but didn't have enough character and enough intellect to tell himself, listen, if I put this here, someone else has to pick it up. And I don't want to be a person who creates trouble for other people. And hence, although however difficult it is, I'm going to have to hold on to this date seed and throw it away. Or the alternative is, which no one will do this, is not to eat the date in the first place, which probably is not an option at all for any of us. So if you're going to eat it, make sure you dispose of it correctly. Small things like this, they don't always have to be very grand things. That these are defining points in what kind of a personality a person has. And it starts with something small like this. If you're able to control yourself from littering within the masjid, the worst place you can litter is within the masjid. If you want to litter, go litter outside, right? You won't, right? Because someone's going to write you a ticket for $1,000 for throwing a cup or a date seed on the floor. But in the masjid, you shouldn't do it. So it starts with something small like this, and it leads to something great. If you're able to refrain from doing that, tomorrow you'll refrain from doing something that has grander effects than someone just coming and having to pick up your cup or your date seed or teacup or whatever after you. So in the lives of the Ahlul Bayt alayhi salatu wasalam, you'll see this idea of public service is at the forefront. And they're always pushing this idea of be of service to other people. It's the best thing you can do. We have narrations, many narrations say the best action that a believer can do is to serve people. Just serve people, that's it. The best worship you can do is to serve another person. Is to remove hardship from the life of another person. That's all Islam wants you to do. There are traditional forms of worship and there are more applicable and acts of worship that have some sort of social utility. So you'll find, I mean, Imam Ali salatu wasalam, public servant, number one. In the day, he was there to meet the needs of the people, and at night, when everyone was done, Imam Ali salatu wasalam was just beginning his night shift, going from house to house and making sure any need that existed within each house that the Imam was able to remove that. There's narration from Imam Sajjad alayhi salatu wasalam that they say he was once riding on whatever mode of transportation he had, whether it was a horse, whether it was a camel, whether it was a donkey, whatever. He was riding, they say, as he was riding in the alley, he saw that there was a little piece of rock or a little lump of clay or earth that was on the floor. Not a big deal. A person can easily walk around it or walk on it, but usually doesn't create that much of a problem. They say the Imam, as he was riding, stopped, got off of his animal, and kicked that clay or that stone to the side. And his companions were confused. They say, you are the Imam, you are the Wali of Allah, your purpose is to create people. Your purpose is, like we said last night, to be able to manage the affairs of the Muslim community. Why are you getting off your horse or getting off your camel to kick a piece of clay off of the road? He said, small things like this will guarantee paradise for people. Why? Because it's a culture that's important. Don't look at the act itself. Look at the philosophy and the culture behind it. It may be one date seed that you're picking up today. Tomorrow you're able to remove bigger problems and bigger hardships from the lives of people. But if you keep looking at the act and say, this is not a big deal. If I leave a cup here, it's not a big deal. If I don't kick this rock out, no one's going to trip over this. They really have to be a klutz to trip over a rock on the street, right? They have eyes. But thinking that, can this help someone potentially? Yes, let me do it. Will it take much effort? No. That builds something within you, that every time you're confronted with an opportunity like this, it just becomes second nature. You don't have to think about it to say, is it worth my time? Is someone going to have a celebration of me after I do these things? No. No one may know. You may come in and clean the masjid, your house, whatever. No one may know. The point is not to be praised. The point is for a person to create that akhlaq, create that characteristic within himself. And like we said, the main point in all is tazkiyah, right? To purify people, This is a very easy form of purification to show people that don't look at the value of that act, don't look at how big or small it is. Look at what's being done and why you're doing it. Throughout the life of Imam Ali, you'll find that this was constant. People, when they wanted something, when they needed something, when they had no other resource, no other outlet to be able to remove their hardships, the first place they went to was the house of Imam Ali. Because they knew when they went there, their hardships, their difficulties would be addressed. They say Imam Sajjad in Medina, he was financially supporting approximately 100 families. 100 families the Imam was financially supporting, not telling them, inshallah, Allah will help you in the next life, it's nice there, right? No, it's not just the moral support, we're almost there, you know, you're not going to live that much long, I know God told me. No, financially supporting. And the Imam is not some, you know, very, very well-off millionaire, that, oh my, how is the Imam doing this? You know, it's Baytul Mal, he must have, no. He said he knew that he can be able to help in small amounts. But he was able to remove a hardship and a difficulty to people. They say when he ate, when he was having food, he liked for him to share his food and break bread with orphans, with people who had physical disabilities, who were poor. He liked to break bread with these people. And the Imam said every time he would eat a meal, he would also, half of that he would do, he would try to give in charity. So if he's having a burger, he would give a burger to charity. If he's having some Quraysh, he'd give it to charity as well. This is something that we need to try and make a part of our lives. Okay, yes, there are certain things that it's not as easy as saying, okay, I want to eat with people, so should I let strangers in my house and kind of leave the door open? Maybe that's being a little naive. Maybe the social circumstances will not allow for something like that. Something that's controlled, although can be done. Maybe you're not going to pick up every homeless person off the street and bring them in, because it's dangerous to your family. But in controlled environments, it's possible. And when you build that sort of personality, that when you're eating always, you're thinking about another person, a less fortunate person than you, is it possible for me to be able to address a problem with another? And if you're conscious of that, that's the first step for you to be able to do something. If you're not conscious, you're not going to do anything, because you're not thinking about it. So the first two characteristics is for a person to be the source of goodness, and for you to also not be the source of something that's evil and that creates hardship. The third characteristic, the Imam states, يَسْتَكْثِرُ قَلِيلَ الْخَيْرِ مِنْ غَيْرِهِ وَيَسْتَقِلُّ كَثِيرَ الْخَيْرِ مِنْ نَفْسِهِ. So this is 3 and 4. The Imam says that a person who has a complete intellect is an individual who takes his grand services, all of the good things that he's done that are in great volume, and he shrinks them. And he says these are valueless. If I've done 100 things that are good, really in reality I haven't done very much. I can do more. I haven't done enough. I can be better. But on the flip side, he takes a small thing that another has done and makes it big. One small thing that a person does, he's always talking about it. He's always reminding people about it. And again, you'll find this within the attitudes of the Ahlul Bayt and the Holy Prophet. A lot of times maybe when we're not thinking straight, when we're not thinking clearly, when our mind is cluttered, we seem to forget a lot of the services that others have done for us and have done in helping us get to this stage. Easy examples are parents, easy examples of their parents, people who have some sort of right over us, our teachers, our educators, our mentors, people who've taught us something. Very easy we can forget all of the goodness that they've done for us. For example, let's say someone in my position has honestly, truthfully, has been able to help you somewhat. I haven't, but let's say someone has. They've taught you something that is valuable to you and is important to you in your life. And in some circumstance, in some occasion, the person who's not like me, okay, says something, does something that's uncalled for. I have a reaction to you, I say something that's uncalled for, it's out of line. That person can do one of two things. He can say that, oh, what's his problem, right? Like, you want to go outside? Let's go outside, right? Like, very easily, like, become very confrontational and say, like, oh, who do you think you are? Like, you know, or he can think for a second and say, okay, yeah, he's in the wrong here. But at the same time, there's a lot of good that this person has done. And out of respect for this person, I'm able to, like, forgive them or move past that. And you'll see the person will be very easy to come and make up and console. So being reactive like that, we should always be conscious of what sort of responsibility others have among us. This is a very, very important mental exercise. Reflection. what responsibilities, rights do others have on me, that whether I'm conscious or not conscious of? So you start with the most easy examples, and then you work your way and see how far you can get. So you start with, let's say, your parents, easy. They care for you, they take care of everything for you. You move forward, then you'll, in society, people I have not met, people necessarily not in my generation, in my lifetime, will further back, the imams, the prophets, further back. Maybe you'll get to end this chain at Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, maybe. So the further back a person is able to go and reflect on this, then he sees society, he sees the world, he sees his life, he sees others in a different light. He doesn't say like, what have you ever done for me? Who are you? I'm a self-made man, self-made woman. You didn't help me, I had nothing, and I created everything for myself. That's very naive thinking. That's very selfish thinking. No, you didn't create anything. If you're truthful to that idea and that statement, then you have to look at Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in Surah Dah says, أَلْأَطْلَمِنَا الْإِنسَانِ حِينُ مِنَ الدَّهِ لَمْ يَكُنْ شَيْئًا مَذْكُورًا. So you were nothing. You were nothing, you didn't exist. If you're self-made man, woman, then you should have created yourself. So there's someone or something that's doing something for you, you have to acknowledge that. And again, acknowledging that, then you're able to praise and give thanks to that person. This is important. In the life of the Holy Prophet, you'll find that even he would be constantly reminding people of good characteristics of people who are not Muslim, mushrikeen. Good characteristics they had, the Prophet was acknowledging of that. There was a man by the name of Abu al-Bakhtari during the time of the Holy Prophet. He was a mushrik, he wasn't Muslim. And even after Islam was presented, he never accepted Islam. But when the Holy Prophet was in a position where others were coming and abusing him, were using derogatory language, were making fun of him, he would stop them. He says, this is unnecessary. It isn't within good moral etiquette for a person to use language like this, for a person to belittle another, for a person to make fun of another. He doesn't believe in the Prophet, there's nothing invested in him protecting the Prophet, other than his good morals, other than this. So it doesn't matter who the other person is. A person should feel responsible. This is unnecessary. There's no reason to do this. And the Prophet would constantly praise people like this, say they had good akhlaq. And when the time came for the Battle of Badr, he instructed his commanders and his soldiers, said, if you see Abu al-Bakhtari and you're faced with him, don't kill him. He said, why? He's mushrik. He says, he has the good akhlaq. And because he did this thing, his life is saved. So it's not about saving a life or not saving a life. It's just about having a good characteristic, the Prophet's acknowledging of them. Constantly, the Prophet, frequently he was acknowledging of the services of Lady Khadija. Constantly, Lady Khadija gave her life, gave her wealth, gave her everything. Everything for Islam, everything for me. And then some of our scholars say that some of us, for those who are married, for those who are not married, maybe to our mothers, to our parents, that we have wives that are still alive and we don't sing their praises at all, ever. We can never say a good thing about them. Not in front of them and not behind their bed. We can't even do the good ghaibat about them, right? We can never say one good because it's, I don't know, it's beneath us? I'm not sure. Right? We have stories that during the time of the Prophet, someone came and complained about his parents. He said, my father has never hugged me, he's never kissed me. So they can't show that affection. Why? I don't know. There's something wrong with, so no, it's easy. It's good to break that sort of, the hardness within the heart, become humble and sing the praises of people that are not necessarily like you or not necessarily have the same ideology as you. And for those who are, you should do it more than you can, as much as you can. A good example for those of us that are from Iranian backgrounds, look, we had 8 years of sacred defense, okay? 8 years, we had tens of thousands, if not hundreds of thousands, shaheed. People were martyred in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, without a doubt. No person went there for their personal affairs and personal gains, right? No one was being written a check to go and fight and defend. But what is the outcome? What is the reaction of leadership there? See how much Imam Khomeini gave respect and said that everything that we have from this revolution is from the blood of the martyrs. He says, my leader are those young people who gave their lives at war. These are my leaders. And it continues until today. How many years afterwards? How many decades afterwards you'll find Ayatollah Khamenei constantly visiting the families of Shuhada, families of martyrs. It's giving respect to them. It's showing them that it's not something small that they did now. It's probably a bad example because what they did is not small. It's enormous. It's invaluable. You can't put a price on it. You can't. But showing that respect, that however little that you can, it goes a long way. It's important for a person to respect and pay respects to people who have done good. So the third and fourth characteristic are people who, when others do something good, they make a big deal out of it. When they do something good, they keep it quiet and really don't make a big deal out of it as much. Salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad.
So we've got through four. The fifth, the Imam says, La yas'amu min talab al-hawa'ij ilay. A person who has a complete intellect, a Muslim who has a complete intellect, is an individual who doesn't become tired or doesn't become drained when people are constantly referring to him and asking for something. They have needs and they come to you and ask for something. A person doesn't become tired and say, oh, it's enough. Like, I helped one person, the second person comes, it's enough. Like, I helped one person, right? Allah said to help people, but I have to take care of myself. I have my own life too. I can't care about other people. I have my own family, and then you get upset. I helped 10 people. I gave $5. That's enough for this year, right? Like, how much money do they need? What are they doing with my money? Or like, I helped one poor person, one needy person. If I'm going to have to feed everyone, then I'm going to go broke myself. I'm going to have to join them. So, oh my God, you know. No, just relax. The Imam is saying, don't sweat it. Just take it one case at a time. And the more that comes to you, that should be a sign of Allah's mercy. Because He's sending them your way. He's not going to send people to an individual who is unworthy. So there's something there that you have that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants you to distribute to other people. Again, you'll find this within the characteristics of the Ahl-Bayt alayhi wassalatu wassalam. In Surah Dahr again, that we recited the first verse, we all know the story of Ahl-Bayt when Imam Hassanayn alayhi wassalam were ill, and a vow was made, a nazir was made, that if they were able to gain good health, then they would perform these actions, they would take fast. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, what about this? In verse 7 it starts, يُوفُونَ بِالنَّذْ, right? وَيَخَافُونَ يَوْمًا كَانَ شَرُّهُ مُسْتَتِرًا. They were able to fulfill their vow, and they fear a day whose ill will be widespread. So what happened? They made a vow, they were held true to their vow, and now it's time to break fast. وَيُطْعِمُونَ الطَّعَامَ. They feed people as well. عَلَى حُبِّهِ. For the sake of Allah, for the love that they have for Allah, مِسْكِينًا وَيَتِيمًا مَأْسِيرًا. We all know the story, right? Three nights back to back. When it was time for iftar, they gave their iftar to people who were needy. Miskinan, yatiman, wasir. So imagine you make a vow to Allah, say, I'm going to fast 3 nights. Like, my child is sick, my father is sick, my mother is sick, inshallah everyone's in good health. You say, I make this vow, I'm going to perform a fast. The first night you're starving, right? You're starving, it's ready to eat. Someone knocks on your door, you're not expecting them. I'm a miskin, I'm poor. Are you going to give your food to them? Or are you going to say, well, you know, actually there's a shelter right here, right? There's a food bank over here. I think they're still open. If you want, I can give you their number. Like, you don't even offer to drive them. So the first night. Yatiman, the second night. Two nights. The second night, if you give your food the first night, you're going to feel pretty good about yourself. The second night, when the person comes and knocks on the door, say, listen, man, someone came last night, I gave my food to them, all right? You should have been with him, because I already gave it once. I'm hungry now, I need to eat. The third night, I know the first night I wouldn't give, but if for whatever reason I give the first and second, the third night I'm not messing with anybody, I'm not joking with anybody, I'm hungry now. This is my food, I gave to two people, okay? Go to another person's house, I'm sure they have plenty of food. But I'll wait, no, three times over. One, two, three. So they get tired and say, you know, Allah, you know, what's going on here? You know, we're fasting, right? But why do you keep sending people this way? You know, there's houses here and there. No. إِنَّمَا نُطْعِمُكُمْ لِوَجْهِ اللَّهِ لَا نُرِيدُ مِنْكُمْ جَزَاءً وَلَا شُكُورًا. We don't even want any thanks or any sort of reward from you either. Again, we have this in akhlaq and personalities of our ulama. There's a story from one of our great scholars, Shaykh Abdul Qayyim al-Riyazi, which some of you are familiar. He's the founder of the Hozan Qom. So he has a lot of right over any student, any scholar who studied there. Great scholars studied under this personality. There's a very famous story that one night late at night, it's late at night, so he was sleeping, and he had a helper, a servant that worked in his house, and then in the middle of the night, someone comes and knocks on the door. So the servant gets up to see who it is. He opens the door, sees a woman there, and she's telling him that, you know, Sheikh Abdul Karim, is he here? So yes, he's like, I need help. My husband's sick, we don't have any food, and we're out of like any sort of wood to be able to turn on a fire to keep us warm, and I don't have any medicine as well. Is there any way you can help us? So the servant trying to serve Sheikh Abdul Karim properly sleeping. He's not going to wake up and be like, there's a lady here. He says, listen, okay, we'll help you, right? But it's late at night. I can't do really anything for you right now. So why don't you come in the morning and I'll see what I can do for you. And the lady, she was kind of disappointed, but she left. She wasn't very persistent. She left. And Sheikh Abdul Karim, even though he was sleeping, apparently he heard the noise and he overheard what had happened. And when he came out of the room, he told his helper, and he said that, what would you do on the Day of Judgment when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asks, we send someone to your house for you to help them, and you turn them away? So he asked his helper, do you know where this woman lives? She said, yes, she's actually from our neighborhood, from our community. She lives a few houses down. So Sheikh Abdul Karim says, okay, let's go. And then his servant says, this is in the middle of the winter. It's snowing, it's hard for you. He said, no, get up, let's go. So they go, they find this woman, and they see, yes, her husband's actually sick. So Sheikh Abdul Karim, in the middle of the night, he instructs his servant to go find a doctor. He brings a doctor to give medicine. He brings food, and he brings some sort of water or something to be able to turn on the fire and keep them warm. And then he asks the servant, he says, how much meat do you generally buy for us on a daily or on a weekly basis? He says, this much. He says, okay, from now on, you're going to half this. Half of it comes to them, and half of it comes to us until they're able to sustain themselves and get back on their feet. And then after he did all those things, then he told his servant, okay, now it's time to go to sleep. Let's go to sleep now. And they come back home. So again, in those circumstances, even if someone that we know, maybe for someone that we know comes and knocks on the door at 3 in the morning, are you crazy? I need help. Come back in the morning. I'm busy right now. I'm tired. So you'll find these characteristics existing within the personalities of our scholars and Ahlul Bayt. Moving forward, the next characteristics that we have, وَلَا يَمَلُّ مِنْ طَلَبِ الْعِلْمِ طُولَ دَهْرِ. This is number seven now. So he says, a person whose intellect is complete is an individual who doesn't become tired from constantly gaining knowledge throughout his life. So again, as far as learning, education is important. It's important for us not to fall into this fantasy of thinking that education is only, for example, when we're younger, we go to grade school, then we go to some sort of a university for higher education, we get a bachelor's degree, a master's degree, then I'm done. I've been studying for 10 years, 15 years, I'm sick of studying. I don't want to study anymore. Like, that's enough for my life. I'm going to live 50 years, 60 years, however long. If I've dedicated 10, 15 years to it, that should be sufficient. And that's, again, I think it's an improper way to address education, to approach education. Education is not, this serves one purpose, but there are a lot of other things that we are meant to learn, and we're meant to learn for many aspects of our life and in different points of our life. So if all of your education is all of it's compressed within your early years of your life, then the things you need to learn to be able to sustain yourself later on in life is going to come where? It's going to come how? It's going to come when? So this shows the importance of having facilities like these. It's important for us to have that sense of education moving forward. So the pillar of every Islamic center that we have within America and anywhere it may be, they should always be houses of education. That should be the core of any Islamic center. Education, 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 the forefront. Of all the things that we do, we have to make sure there's always an educational component there, and the education should address those things that are important to us in different stages of our lives. You'll find a lot of younger people that they may be very well versed in certain educations, even certain religious and Islamic educations, but in other things they're absolutely, completely have no idea what's going on. Good examples, when it comes to establishing a family, when it comes to marriage, a lot of kids don't know what they're supposed to do, what they're supposed to look for. They don't know how to find a spouse, they don't know what to look for in a spouse, they don't know how to manage their marital affairs, they don't know how to raise their children. And it's just kind of like bits and pieces they pick up from here and there. And that becomes the essence of their education when it comes to raising a family. Isn't that a very poor form of education for a person to have? When they're trying to raise a family and be able to train another person and present them to society for them to be good, for them not to have any sort of formal education. So this is something that should be concerning to us. When they get older, when they want to give their kids off, they don't know what to do because no one has ever taught them. No one has ever taught them how to deal with these things. And hence you find a lot of problems coming within our community because there's no sort of formal education. Always education has to be that, you know, again, these are not La ilaha illallah, Allah is great, Allahu Akbar. These are good. These are, yes, understanding this is all of education, all of knowledge. But if you find something is recycled or repetitive, then you should feel responsible to say something, or at least change the channel, right? Why do you keep auditing the same class that you've taken a million times? You're not required to. If you've already taken this class, you already know these things, then move on to the next one. Don't just say, for the sake of me learning something and saying that I'm a student, let me just sit in here, but I already know all these things. No, you should always try to challenge yourself and try to learn things that you feel like you haven't mastered yet. And I think that's something we should always try to remind ourselves and not be naive and say like, well, I've been saying this majalis like for a whole lifetime. Like, what is it that you're going to tell me that I don't know? I'm not going to be able to tell you anything because I don't know anything. But maybe a person that knows something more, that has spent his time to learn something that's a little bit more specific and a little bit more detailed, can contribute something to us. So ask that of yourselves and ask that of your peers and of your Islamic community in your masjid. The Imam continues, 2 points. Al-faqru fi Allahi ahabbu ilayhi min al-ghina wa al-dhullu fi Allahi ahabbu ilayhi min al-izz fi aduwwi. These two things. He says that poverty or being needy in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is more pleasurable to him than a person who is wealthy. وَالذُّلُّ فِي اللَّهِ أَحَبُّ إِلَيْهِ مِنْ الْعِزَّ فِي عَدُوِّهِ. And for him to be not honored, for him to not be respected at the level that others are, but in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is more pleasurable to him than for him to have honor and prestige, but in frameworks that are not reflective of Islamic ideologies. So, you can be wealthy, but being wealthy how? You can be rich, but being rich how? At what cost? You can be honored, people can honor you, you can be very prestigious, but what are the values here? What defines prestige here? So there are certain things that Islam defines as prestige, and there are certain things that maybe society will define as prestige, and they're not the same as how Islam sees it. If you look in the Holy Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes it very clear. In Surah Nisa, verse 138-139, بَشِّرِ الْمُنَافِقِينَ بَأَنَّ لَهُمْ عَذَابًا أَلِيمًا. Inform the hypocrites that there's a painful punishment for them. الَّذِينَ يَتَّخِذُونَ الْكَافِرِينَ أَوْلِيَاءَ مِنْ دُونِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ. They take the faithless or people who are kuffar for their allies and their wali instead of the faithful. أَيَبْتَغُونَ عِنَّهُمُ الْعِزَّةِ فَإِنَّ الْعِزَّةَ لِلَّهِ جَمِيعًا. Do you seek honor with them? Know that all honor belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In Surah Yunus, verse 65, وَلَا يَحْسُنْكَ قَوْلُهُمْ. Don't let their remarks grieve you or bother you. إِنَّ الْعِزَّةَ لِلَّهِ جَمِيعًا وَالسَّمِيعُ الْعَلِيمُ. All honor, all prestige, all pride belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is one that gives pride and prestige to others. Yes, maybe in society if you're a doctor, you have a doctor degree, you have a PhD, people will call you Ay Doctor, and you get very happy. That's good. It's good to be educated. Ay Mohandis, Mr. Engineer. Okay, it's good. It's good to have education. It's good to be learning. No one is saying to not go and learn so that maybe someone will call you Ay Doctor and you'll be so... No. No, you should go learn things, but whether a person calls you Ay Doctor or not, doesn't call you Ay Doctor, it shouldn't really be like a very important thing, right? Whether you drive a really nice car or whether you drive a not so nice car. Again, the point is not for you to go buy the worst cars, right? No, you should buy something that's reliable that gets the job done. Again, it's not about buying a small, cramped house that no one is comfortable. No. But whatever is defined as prestige within society, if it is in line with Islamic teachings, alhamdulillah, good. You should try to achieve it. But if it's not, then at what cost? What sort of prestige and honor is that? Is it worth it? And what are you losing from trying to acquire these things? You say, I want to go and become a doctor. I want to go become an engineer. At what cost? Are you willing to sacrifice your spiritual development just so that someone later will call you Ay Doctor? Right? You're willing to send your child thousands of miles away because they're going to a top university. And then when they come back, you find that they're very intellectual, but they have very low moral standing. Again, there's no correlation between the two. Doesn't mean if your children go to school out of state that they're going to become terrible people. No. But it happens more often than not. And these are things that we need to decide as parents, as students. Is it worth it for me to engage in this activity when I know it's detrimental to other aspects of my life that should be important to me? The friends that I have, the people I associate with, the places that I work. These are very, very delicate and critical things. If we want to go deeper and deeper into these issues, then it may become very problematic because it's not very pragmatic and it's not very realistic. we start to think about who we work for, what sort of services we offer these companies, what sort of services these companies offer the world, you're going to have a difficult time sleeping at night. So unfortunately, we're not at the level to be able to address these things yet. If I work for the largest, if I work in the defense industry, and I'm helping create all of these bombs that are used not to bomb me, they're used to bomb other people, and I think most of the bombs are being used in to bomb Muslim countries. So if I want to think about something like this, that I'm being paid six digits to create, for example, this technology that's being used to this, sometimes I may find myself having difficulty sleeping and have to kind of not think about it, right? So these are the things that we have to also reflect on, that at what cost am I willing to do something? And I think the culture and the legacy of Imam was about this, right? It says, "Hey, hatimna dhilla." When Imam says that I can't live to stand for something like this. And I think it's honorable for me to give my life and the life of my family to stand for something that's right. And this is what this hadith is trying to say. So what are those red lines that you define for yourself to say, when it comes to this point, I can't stand for this anymore, at whatever cost it may be. However much they want to honor me, and however much prestige it may bring me, however much material possessions and wealth they may give to me, I'm not willing to sacrifice my ideals for them. And you'll find most people in the tragedy of Ashura were not able to make the right choice, right? Because when the amount of money, the amount of wealth, the amount of position, prestige, power came, most people had a price, and the enemies of the Imam were very well aware of that, and they were able to capitalize on something like that. So that's the seventh and eighth, and we have two more. The ninth, the Holy Imam states, وَالْخُمُولُ أَشْهَى إِلَيْهِ مِنَ الشُّغْرَ. He says that for a person to perform actions, or generally for him to live, if I can paraphrase, under the radar, in secrecy, to do acts of goodness in secrecy, in private, in ways that people don't find out, is more pleasurable to him than for him to do it publicly. So, we've already established that a person needs to be a public servant, but being a public servant can be two ways. People can sing your praises every day, and every time you enter a room, people need to sing your praises and have banners of you, and name halls after you, and have schools built after you. Or you can get the work done, and no one necessarily has to know. Now, if someone happens to see you, you don't have to like wear a cape and like wear a mask and cover your face to make sure no one does. But a person's objective should be to get the work done, and not necessarily for other people to know. And sometimes you'll find this, that people will do good, but again, they want that aspect of other people to know that I've done good. Like, I want to contribute to a very worthy cause, but at the same time, I want people to like mention my name in the microphone. And if they don't, then I get like very offended, and I don't give money anymore, right? Like, I want this hall to be named after my family. If they don't name it after my late father, then I'm gonna burn the masjid down, right? Because I gave like $50,000 to the masjid. Or I have a big wall. Again, I'm not saying necessarily these are good or bad things. I have a wall here that these are all of the donators. Maybe there's good to this. People will see it and say, wow, others have helped. I want to contribute as well. There can be positivity to it, but at the same time, you don't want in your face like, oh, these are the people who gave money to us. And if your name's not there, oh, why is your name up there? You don't give money to the masjid? You don't, because sometimes they have levels, like gold plaque. Like, top tier, you have to give $10,000. Like, $100, you don't make it. You just get a special mention, special thanks to, and they kind of just, like, go through it quickly. Right? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Holy Quran, Surah Baqarah says, in tubdu sadaqat fa ni'mahi, if you disclose your charities, that's good. Wa in tukhfuha wa tu'tuha al-fuqara fa huwa khayrun lakum. If you're able to do that in some sort of hidden form, that's better for you. That's problematic. If people start knowing that, first of all, okay, practically, if you start giving money and people recognize you, I'll tell you, if I need help, the first person I'm going to come to your door at 3 a.m. Tell you, if you gave a lot of money to the masjid, I need help. Right? So that may be even problematic at that level. To be able to hide it, then people don't know. Everyone thinks you're, oh, you don't have, oh, I don't have anything. I can't help you. But I'm giving good money like to the masjid. to the orphans or to Fuqara or something. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, if you give and people see it, that's good. Many cases it's good for people to see it. Oh, I'm doctor, I'm gonna give. So the other doctor, you look at the other doctor, you're like, I'm gonna put $10,000 down, and you look at the other doctor and you make eye contact and say, oh, I gotta put money too, right? So that's good, it's promoting, right? فَاسْتَبِقُوا الْخَيْرَاتِ. That's good. When it comes to doing good things, challenge each other. Well, the person puts 1,000, I put 2,000, I put 3,000, and then before you know, you have hundreds of thousands of dollars to make the nice khurish. So, it's good. It's good to make sure you do good, but to have that personality of, if people don't know, it's not important. Like, I don't feel shortchanged if I do something good and no one doesn't know about it. Like, I do something nice in the house sometimes for the younger people. Like, I do something nice in the house and I want my parents to know so they acknowledge that I help. It's not important. You take out the trash, no big deal. They'll notice, right? They didn't do it. They'll notice that you took it. It's okay. And finally, the last one. The Holy Imam doesn't immediately say the 10th one. ثُمَّ قَالْ الْعَاشِرَةْ وَمَا الْعَاشِرَةْ. He says then the 10th one. And what do you know what the 10th one is? And then the narrator asks, قِيلَ لَهُ. It was said to him, مَا هِيَ. What is the 10th one? The 10th characteristic. He said, no person's intellect will be complete without it. قَالَ عَلَيْهِ السَّلَامُ لَا يَرَى أَحَدًا إِلَّا قَالَ هُوَ خَيْرٌ مِنِّي وَأَتْقَى. The last one that he's completing this with says that a Muslim who has complete intellect should never see another person and think that I'm better than them. لَا يَرَى أَحَدًا إِلَّا قَالَ. You should see that person and you should say this, should profess this. هُوَ خَيْرٌ مِنِّي وَأَتْقَى. Don't say he's a good person and he's a pious person. That's one thing to say that he's good. The Imam says, say he's better than you. I do my nawaz so good. I have such a nice beard. Nawaz shab, no one knows about it, but I tell people, I give sadaqah, you know, I fund all these. No. The Imam says, look at that person that you think he's the worst of the worst. Then he continues. And inshallah, we'll end with this. Innama nas rajulun. That people know that there are two types of people. رَجُلٌ خَيْرٌ مِنْ وَأَقْفَى وَرَجُلٌ شَرٌ مِنْ وَأَدْنَى. Know that realistically, if you're comparing people, yourself with others, either the person truly is better than you, he's more pious than you, or he's not, okay? He's worse than you. And then he continues, فَإِذَا لَقِيَ الَّذِي شَرٌ مِنْ. If you actually came in the presence of a person that is really worse than you, or you think is worse than you, وَأَدْنَى قَالَ لَعَلَّ خَيْرَ هَذَا بَاطِمٌ وَهُوَ خَيْرٌ لَهُ وَخَيْرِ ظَاهِرٌ وَهُوَ شَرٌ لِهُ. This is now, the Imam took it to the next level. So you see a person that you know is worse than me, this guy's not a Muslim. He only comes once a year to the masjid. I know he doesn't fast, he just comes for eight, so he can feast with us. It's okay. The Imam says, look at that person and say that perhaps it's like this, that his goodness is inner, within, it's hidden. And that's good for him. But my goodness, my virtues are all outside, exterior, and everyone can see it. And that's a flaw of mine. That the only goodness that I have is one that other people see. And sometimes we have these problems, even within our masjids, even within our community. Someone comes, it doesn't fit the proper bill. Oh, what's this guy doing here? He must be a spy. He must be an informant. Oh, don't talk to him. He's not from Middle East. Oh, this American guy here? No, man, he's trouble. He sent him here. I know I'm invading my taxes. He's here for me, right? I didn't pay my taxes this year. He's here to get me. No, not everyone is like that, right? Someone who comes here once a year that you know is a bad person, is doing bad things, or you don't know, you just speculate. And Mom says you should have this sort of... So if you have that sort of opinion from a person, then you're never gonna push that person to the side. Many centers, people come, they sit there by themselves, like they come for 10 days, they're just sitting by themselves. No one comes in and says, sit down to the person. Comes and eats our food, he doesn't even put anything in the donation box, right? And then the person feels not welcome, and then what do? They let them leave. And say, Alhamdulillah, we kicked this guy out, Jasus, we kicked him out of here, you know, he's not here anymore. And we have a party for you. Okay, over here it's not like this, very welcoming family style. You know, I'm sure everyone that comes here feels very welcome. But you may have experienced, we've experienced in places that people don't feel like that. And especially if they don't come from our ethnic backgrounds. Or they don't share the same sort of ideology. How does this guy, for example, doesn't wear his Islam on his sleeve? His velayat on his sleeve. He doesn't have his Ya Zahra hit man or John Al-Fadaya Ahbar hit man, okay? It's okay. Maybe he doesn't even respect these people. But he respects God, he praises God. Bring him here. If we truly have the potential, then let's help him understand why these things are important. Don't say, فوش رحمت داد بندازش بیرون. فوش امام داد دیگه. بندازش بیرون. کافر شده. No. So be welcoming of people. We said, yes, unity, right? Unity. Be welcoming of people. Even a non-Muslim comes here and says, what are you doing here? It's a masjid. Get out of here. No, be welcoming. How can I help you? Welcome to our masjid. And make sure we have those sort of functions as well. If this building is here and non-Muslims don't come in here, then I'll tell you they're feeling suspicious. What's happening in that office building? All these Middle Eastern people, brown people are coming in here. What do they do? Right? Bring them here, tell them nothing. We just come and eat food and we throw date seeds here and there, and you can do that too. This is where you can hide them. Right? It's okay. Ittihad. Unity. So the Imam says the first person is like that. وَإِذَا رَأَى أَلَّذِي هُوَ خَيْرٌ مِنْ If you see a person who's better than you, أَتْقَى تَوَاضَعَ لَهُ يَلْحَقَ بِهِ فَإِذَا فَعَلَ ذَلِكَ فَقَدْ عَلَى مَجْدُهُ وَطَابَ خَيْرُهُ وَحَسُنَ ذِكْرُهُ وَصَادَ أَهْلَ زَمَانِهِ If you see a person that's truly better than you, then try to learn from him. Try to be like him. Don't get jealous and say, oh, this guy is, oh, this namaz really well. I see his zikr is so good. I'm going to follow him in his car and see where he's going. Oh, you're going to restaurant McDonald's. Oh, okay. I'm going to make sure everyone knows about it. It's no big deal. So what? If he's good, try to learn from him. He's a truthful person, try to learn from that. He's a nice, honest person, try to learn from that. And try to better yourself. Imam says if you have this sort of approach through ideology, then you'll become the better person. If you don't have these things, then he says there's something wrong with you in the head. That's what the Imam is saying, right? Sifatul Aqil. A person who has intellect is complete. So if you have incomplete intellect, so there's something wrong with you, right? You got a screw loose. So Imam says tighten the screws in your heads like this. With these 10 characteristics, among other characteristics that you'll find in other ahadith as well, inshallah. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, by the right of the Holy Imam, al-Ridha alayhi salatu wasalam, of this teaching that inshallah we can try to implement these sort of characteristics within our lives. Inshallah, I ask all of you to forgive me. Again, I do apologize for the many shortcomings that I definitely do have. And I pray that inshallah Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be able